We will call the meeting to order. This is the, I don't even know the date. It is the October 19th Village Council meeting, Yellow Springs Village Council meeting. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Wintrom?
Here.
Hausch?
Here.
McQueen?
Here.
Not here this evening, at least as of yet, are council members Lori Aslan and Jerry Sims. Present is Village Manager Patty Bates, Assistant Village Manager Melissa Van Zant, and Police Chief Dave Hale, along with our solicitor, Chris Connard.
Welcome, everyone. And at our places, we have a pink ribbon, thanks to our Village Manager Patty Bates, to recognize Breast Cancer Awareness Month. I'm glad I'm wearing pink. It matches my outfit, so.
And there are some more down there on the end, if anyone would like to help yourself.
Thank you. Let's see, the announcements that are here, we have, is Robin here?
Robin?
Is not here.
May be thinking 7 o'clock, although we did let her know.
Okay.
But she may walk in at 7 o'clock, so.
Okay. Another announcement to make is that October 29th, we have a special meeting of council to discuss the ACE Task Force. And we will have, I think we may discuss it later this evening, the agenda and who will all be present. November 2nd is Election Day. Is that November 2nd? Is that the?
Yes.
November 3rd?
November 3rd?
Yeah.
Okay, don't go there on November 2nd. So November 3rd is Election Day, and we have charter amendments on the ballot. And also, there is a levy for Green County Parks, and I would like to give a personal endorsement. Am I allowed to do that, Chris? If I say it's personal? I know you really like that one, huh? Just to remind you how important Green County Parks are.
Yes.
They are the manager of our trail system.
And.
Brian?
Yeah, I have a few other announcements. I think it's nice to give a shout out to Yellow Springs Zombie Walk, which is going to be happening this Saturday. And kind of in celebration of that, the Little Art Theater is going to show Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Oh!
10 o'clock.
Which Saturday?
This Saturday.
Gosh.
Yeah, so no throwing any items in the theater.
Oh, man!
But everything else you can do. All right.
If you guys haven't been to Rocky Horror Picture Show, it's an experience.
They're much too young for that.
It's from when I was an undergrad, so, yeah.
Anything else? Mary Ann? No? Okay.
No.
So we will move on. Petitions and communications, we had our treasurer's report in the packet. I think things just continue to move along as far as the investments and our expenses, as far as bank expenses and things are kind of canceling each other out. Nothing really of note, other than she has done some training and is recommending that we look at some of our policies. And I expect that perhaps she and Melissa will be talking in the future, and that might become an agenda item in 2016. Susan Gartner, our lovely station manager, provided two excellent reports, and Channel 5 is incredibly busy, and we appreciate it. The mayor's monthly report, Green County Public Health did have information about their levy renewal, and there will be a town hall meeting. NAMI will be having a town hall meeting Saturday, November 7th, from 9 to 1. And I think that that is at Green Career Center, Green County Career Center, 360 East Enon Road.
Karen, I would like to point out one thing about the parks levy. If the parks levy passes, there will no longer be a required local share for the park maintenance, or the parks and trails maintenance in Green County. Right now, everyone who has a park or part of the trail in their jurisdiction pays a yearly stipend to help maintain the trails and to do projects. If the levy passes, that local share will no longer be required, because all of the funds to maintain the trail will come from the levy.
Excellent, thank you. So agenda review, our agenda has changed quite a bit from what we thought we were going to have on the agenda. We learned I don't know, after our agenda planning meeting on Monday, that we actually cannot have legislation as part of even a first reading, even if we don't take a vote. We can't have that part of a work session. A work session is basically just a talk. It's not a regular meeting. So we can't make decisions and we can't take votes. So what we did with some of the major items that were part of what we were going to do as far as legislation, we just moved them on to old business. And we're also going to have a discussion of the water and sewer rate ordinances during the work session. So that will come up. We will have no legislation to discuss tonight or to review tonight. Anything else about the agenda that anybody would like to say?
Yeah. Brian and I would like to talk about the format for the discussion.
So we'll add that as the third item under old business.
Okay.
Okay, so then we will move on to old business. We thought we were going to have Robin here. I was wondering how the times got so far off. So information regarding the upcoming ordinance to be enacted in accordance with House Bill 5. Who is going to lead that discussion? Our solicitor?
Either Melissa.
You're Melissa?
Or Chris.
Doesn't matter.
Okay, I just, it's a little.
Am I nominated?
You can, because
you're nominated.
There was a lot more involved than I thought, so.
Yeah.
All right, well, the history of this is that on December 19, 2014, the governor signed legislation that made effective on January 1st, 2016, the concept of conformity of all of the municipal tax code. I think Melissa explain what the impact of that is. From the solicitor's perspective, there's a question as to whether or not that legislation that was passed would violate home rule principles. In the context of our discussion, I provided a sample ordinance that Rita prepared, Ohio Municipal League prepared, and it has some language that we probably need to discuss. It says, whereas council also finds and determines that the constitutionality of certain provisions of the state mandated code may have been put in question by recent decisions of the Ohio Supreme Court, it goes on. It talks about the provisions and limitations specified in this ordinance thus reluctantly are adopted by council, but are disclaimed to the extent they are unlawful or unconstitutional. We fully expect that there's going to be some municipalities across the state that will take up the fight. It would be my recommendation that the village wait and see what happens rather than bear the cost of that effort. The ordinance itself that has been presented was a, since we belong to the Regional Income Tax Administrator, Rita, they drafted it for all of the municipalities who are members of Rita, and I worked with Melissa and Patty and Amy Blankenship, and we put together the parts of it that fit for the village. That was submitted to Rita last Thursday, or pardon me, last Tuesday or Monday, and we received a response back Thursday afternoon with some minor changes. It's a 45-page document. In effect, what this legislation does is it does not repeal any of the existing income tax language in our ordinance or in our code because we still will collect taxes in 2016 pertaining to 2015 under the old code, and then there's a statute of limitations period that would be open for the next 3 years. So we're not repealing any legislation, we're simply passing a new section 881 and the revised code of general ordinances that incorporates and reflects the new changes in state law. I'll stop there for a second and see if there's any questions from council before I go on.
Did you have any comments, Patty, or
no.
Melissa?
Melissa and I have pretty much gone through this like Chris and Amy with a fine-tooth comb, so.
Okay.
As And so with the approval of Rita, who actually collects the taxes on behalf of the village, we're comfortable that the ordinances are proper. And so really, I think that to the extent that the villagers know that there will be a minor impact, I think that Melissa's indicated about a $16,000 impact on the village taxes. We really don't have a choice at this point. We have to pass this legislation or be in violation of state law. Every municipality in the state is doing the same thing. And that, in essence, is my report.
And that clause you referenced in the beginning, is that part of this document or is that in the ordinance we will pass?
What happened is that there were two organizations that represent municipalities. We have Rita, who is a member. They provided a template for the revised ordinances, or the ordinances that we passed. That was the document that we worked with that is submitted to council for approval effective January 1st, 2016. The Ohio Municipal League also drafted some legislation for its members. I didn't like how that was done. The Rita process was much easier to follow in the track. The ordinance that was drafted by the Ohio Municipal League I liked better, except that this last whereas clause has a pretty strong political statement in there.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessary. I'm aware of some jurisdictions that are leaving it in. Other jurisdictions are taking it out. We could rewrite it. I think the theory is that some municipalities are, I think, more angry with Columbus for having passed the legislation. And because anytime there's a discussion in certain communities about income tax and the whatever the import of that is and the connotation, it is a political hot button. Fundamentally, it's not going to change tax rates.
And it doesn't state anything that if we don't have that in there, we're going to be penalized. Like there's nothing in there that gives us the opportunity at some future date to do something. It's just political. It's strictly political.
That whereas clause is a purely political statement that has no impact on the legislation whatsoever.
I personally think it's kind of silly. I read it and thought it was kind of silly. So.
Well, and haven't we also realized that the impact for us is sort of neutral?
Right, and I mean, to be quite honest, it's clear that the legislators don't care. I mean, they don't care. So, because they're getting bombarded on a daily basis from elected officials, local elected officials, and they just simply don't care.
Could you remind me anyway, what is the major change, even though it's not gonna impact us that much?
I'm going to defer to Patty or Melissa on that.
I mean, there's just a number of them. The net operating loss for for-profit businesses, it's 5 years carry forward, so it's cutting them a little bit of slack by giving them a longer period of time. It defined a day in terms of if a worker that lives in his home-based employment is outside of a municipality and they go to work in a municipality, like kind of like a contractor or something, if they come to the village for like a day, it defines a day as to where it didn't have a day defined before. And then there was also limitations in there in terms of how many days somebody could work at another municipality before they would have to claim. So it was just a lot of really small things that didn't really impact us. Like Chris said, it's like $16,000 is the net that it's going to affect us at the end of the year. So it's really not a whole lot. It was just a lot of little things really that added up to the major overhaul. But those were the big things that people were worried about, was like transient workers and how long they were going, how long they would have to be somewhere before they would have to turn in income taxes for that municipality. And then the for-profit businesses and their net operating loss definition.
I think it extended the day, so now it has to be something like maybe 6 hours or something, and it also added to the number of days in a row, or number of days in a week or a month that you had to, you could be in a place without paying income tax. So it's, you know, it's part of what the employers were saying, it was too cumbersome. You know, let's say you've got a utility worker, or you've got a repairman who might be in three or four different places in one day. Mm-hmm. Let's say if it was 2 hours, they could, if there was a 2-hour limit on income tax, they would literally be tracking four different municipal income taxes for one day. There is something cumbersome about that for an employer to have to do. So that's part of what they did get through to at least make it a longer day. Basically, it's the preponderance of the day is what it is.
Thank you.
So the plan is that this will be presented to council the first meeting in November. It will be passed as emergency legislation, and will take into effect, go into effect on January 1, 2016. I think that the one provision that probably people need to be aware of is that beginning in January 31st, 2017, landlords will need to provide notice to the tax administrator of their tenants during that year. But there'll be plenty of time to get that notice out.
Okay.
That's in terms of any burden that I don't think exists now for villagers, that would be one.
Okay.
But everything else, I think that most people will find it's very seamless.
Okay. Sounds good. Thanks, Chris. Environmental Commission recommendations regarding the easement priorities. This was a discussion that we started at the last meeting. Mary Ann brought a request to council that we develop some policies around these recommendations. I noticed that on the table there was also a map that had been requested. I had requested a map so that we could kind of understand, since this was a change in really the direction we have been going. So Mary Ann, would you kind of take it from the top and explain this?
Yeah. Over the past, I don't know, maybe decade, I think Tecumseh Land Trust has been looking at properties along the Jacoby Greenbelt, which on this map are in red, as properties that Yellow Springs was potentially interested in conserving, if that was a possibility. Because we have lost monies from the state estate tax and no longer have the kind of modest funding or robust, whatever, adequate funding to put into the Grease Pace Fund, council, I think it was at our retreat, asked the Environmental Commission to review our policy and come back with a recommendation. So we've had a series of three meetings with Tecumseh Land Trust, two with the commission and one with myself and Nadia Malarkey. And what the commission recommends is that our first focus be on properties that are within the 1 and 5 year time of travel for our wells, the wells that provide us with our drinking water, or with our water. And so if you look on this map, sort of down, if you see the little area in purple, that is our wellhead property itself. And then surrounding that in this sort of, I don't know what you say that shape would be. There are two little shapes. What the smaller one is a orange, and the larger one is sort of a yellow orange. The smaller one is considered to be the 1 year time of travel. That means that water coming from that area will come to the wells within 1 year, and the larger circle is the or shape is the 5-year time of travel. So if you look at the smaller circle, you see that on the sort of southeast area is a little area of blue. That would be properties that are not conserved. The green properties are properties that are already have some kind of conservation on them. Within the 5-year time of travel, then there are some larger areas of blue, including Morris Bean plant. So the Environmental Commission felt that those properties in blue should be our first priority in terms of conservation, if we have the opportunity to conserve those properties. Then next in line, we felt, were properties in the Jacoby Greenbelt that actually fronted on Dayton Yellow Springs. And the thought was that it's really Dayton Yellow Springs, first of all, that would have the most potential for being developed, those properties with houses, housing development, and also would have the biggest impact on Yellow Springs. And then from there, we thought the other Jacoby Greenbelt properties in red. And then lastly, what had been called at one point the Country Common properties, which are properties, the properties in blue that are mostly to the east of the Glen and John Bryan Park. So when I was looking at the minutes from the Environmental Commission, I noticed that the minutes were a little different than my notes. And the minutes said that our first choice was the 1-year time of travel. The second priority would be the 5-year and the Greenbelt properties along Dayton Yellow Springs.
And I remember it to the 1 and the 5 to be the first priority together.
Okay, that's what I
And you mentioned the properties in blue, but I mean I would assume that the properties in white within the 1 and 5 year zone are equivalent in desire
yes,
to blue ones.
Yes,
I mean they're all within
true.
That.
That's true.
I've never quite understood what the Country Commons is.
Well, I think that this was
because I thought it was preserved
decades ago. No, when I think it came about the same time when they thought Yellow Springs was going to have a population of 15,000 people, and they wanted to have this big buffer around Yellow Springs. So these properties, the Country Common properties, aren't so much, for the most part, buffering Yellow Springs as they are buffering the Glen and John Bryan Park, buffering green space.
They're buffering the buffer.
Buffering the buffer, yes. Yeah.
Okay. But they never were. I mean, it's just an area they never were preserved. For whatever reason,
yes.
I thought that a lot of it was preserved.
Well,
clearly
if
not.
They're green, they're preserved, and
right.
If they're blue, they're not.
Okay.
And white, I guess, means attention has not been placed.
Well,
right.
I think those are the ones that they felt currently didn't have the potential to even be put under a conservation easement.
Either that or it wasn't as critical.
Right.
Yeah. So I don't know if council has the power to say yes to this.
Well, not tonight, but I think maybe we can. If we want legislation or at least a motion, we would want to put this on the next agenda. So we'll just add this to the next agenda to at least acknowledge, at the least with a motion, which.
The primary purpose for Tecumseh Land Trust is if they know what our priorities are, they won't be sending letters out to those properties in red. Which apparently they do every year. They would probably only send letters out to those properties along that actually front on Dayton Yellow Springs Road.
I think it would probably make sense to have a resolution with these materials attached on the next agenda. We need more legislation on that agenda. Or if not that agenda, maybe another one.
Well, see, Tecumseh needs this sooner than later.
Okay. Well, but we'll get this before the end of the year. It just you see this list of legislation that we have.
Do you think that there's a sense of council that I could report back to the council? Because they'd be sending their letters.
There's certainly a sense from, I shouldn't speak for Brian. There's a sense from me that this makes sense, yes.
This makes sense to me.
And this makes sense to me. Okay.
That's three of us.
Okay.
But we aren't making a decision.
Oh, right.
We're just expressing an opinion.
Yeah.
And speaking of...
Three opinions, which happens to be a majority.
Speaking of your three opinions, Lori has texted she will not be able to make the meeting this evening.
Okay.
She won't be here tonight?
No. So let's move on to the, to Lori, excuse me, to Mary Ann and Brian to talk about the special meeting on October 29th about the ACE task force.
Okay, so there is a piece of paper on your desk table that gives a draft for a potential format for the meeting to talk about the ACE task force. And one thing is this, it's 2 hours. I mean, this agenda would be a 2-hour meeting, which mm-hmm. I think it deserves. I mean, I think given that probably there'll be a lot of people there and we're gonna have some panelists, so that's one decision that council will need to make. But so the first part, 10 minutes would be basically just introducing everyone, setting ground rules, saying what the purpose of the meeting is, and we do have a facilitator from the mediation
program. Yeah, Bernie O'Koon, who's actually worked with the HRC in the past, so she's got some background on the issues.
And Brian and I have not met with her, but we will do that.
Okay.
And then a time for the panelists, which would be our chief and Bruce May, as well as two people yet to be identified, to talk about their concerns about our involvement in the task force. So each of those people would have 5 minutes to make a presentation, and then there'd be a half hour for council to interact with the panelists and or say whatever any of the council members wanted. So we could ask questions of panelists, ask questions of each other, whatever.
I just, 5 minutes, I know that you're trying to keep it on a timetable,
mm-hmm.
but I'm not sure that 5 minutes is a fair amount for any of those four people to adequately. Chief, do you feel you can get your important part in? And
I guess it just depends on what the rest of the time is filled up with.
Yeah. I mean, I would almost say that maybe we should extend the whole thing a little bit and give them a little bit more time at the beginning. I mean, I agree with you, it's an important discussion. I don't think it should be shorted anywhere, even if we have to stay past a couple hours.
So you're suggesting like maybe if we have a 2.5-hour meeting or 2 hours?
No, I was actually going to say we needed to have a hard 2-hour stopping point and to even think about shortening. I agree with Patty. I agree with Patty. So I don't know where the time is going to come from,
yeah.
But
I just
starting out with a 2-hour meeting at 7:00 at night is.
Yeah, I just think it's going to be difficult for any of those four people to adequately explain anything within that time period. I'm just concerned about that.
So
can we do 15 minutes for each subject?
If we gave 30 minutes,
right.
Minutes for each.
So the chief and Bruce combined would have 15 minutes.
Okay.
And
maybe
it's a little bit better, yeah. And then the other two.
Either 20 minutes for council or take it off the community time.
I'd say 30. Let's make it 30.
Yeah,
and 10 to wrap, so that's 90, that's still...
That's 100, you have 20 minutes. Well,
okay.
And 10 at the top, so you have 10 more minutes if you do that.
Okay, so...
You know, we can always choose to extend
as we're in, I'd like to put some hard, a little, maybe a little bit stricter time limits on some of it. And then if there are enough comments, enough time, we feel, we can always decide there that, okay, we're going to take more time.
If you do 10 introduction, then 30, 30, 40, and 10, that puts you at 2 hours.
Well, and I think the other thing to keep in mind is this is not the only discussion.
Right.
Because we will then be making a decision at a regular council meeting, so.
Yeah. Okay.
Are there any other comments?
No, I don't think so.
No.
Chief?
So the main thing that we, so we're keeping this format, just made some changes on the time.
And it is in A and B, correct?
Yes, rooms A and B.
And are there, are we going to be set up the way we were last time?
We'll try something new.
Okay.
We'll work on it.
Will there be, are people using using presentations? Are they using PowerPoints or anything?
I'm not sure. I don't know. One person that I know has a slide PowerPoint. Do you know?
I would like to. I think
okay, so we should set it up so that we can do that.
Yeah, I think it's a better way for people to follow instead of looking at packets. Mm-hmm.
Right. So can we put the big screen TV in rooms A and B by then?
Yeah, we'll figure it. We'll get a television up there.
Okay.
Even if we have to get the one out of the youth center and bring it up for that night.
Okay.
Now, can we live stream or not?
I would have to get help with Paul, like how you did it for Andy just a few months ago. I'd have to have him help me.
So if we could work on that, it would be nice.
Yeah.
But you will be there filming, even if it's not live, okay.
So Jason, will you please make sure we have a television? Thank you.
Okay, done?
Yep.
Yeah. So, Robin? Okay, why don't we, our special guest, Robin Bosnaw, just came in from Greene County Health Department. Combined Health District, I think is the correct. Mm-hmm. So we'll have you come up and make a few comments.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I was a little late.
Can you come up to the podium?
Yeah.
That's.
I wasn't certain that you were talking about maybe having to come present, but I thought maybe I wasn't supposed to be here tonight. I didn't bring a PowerPoint because I wasn't sure of the setup. I'm here representing the health commissioner, who's Melissa Brand. She was Melissa Howell until last week, and she got remarried. And my name is Robin Fazza. I'm the director of community health services. I'm a registered nurse with a master's in public health. And I've been at the health district almost 10 years now. And you probably recognize the health district called Greene County Combined Health District. We want to now be known as Greene County Public Health, and that's sort of keeping in line with the national, what national health departments are called. We've also changed our logo from the long time logo that we had with four arrows to now the shield of public health, which is the national shield. And it has our mission of prevent, promote, and protect. So that's what we do. And I'm here tonight because, basically because we're running for a levy. And my job is to help you understand what all services that we provide at the health district. How much time do I have? I don't want to extend my welcome.
About five.
Okay.
Is that good?
That is perfect. I'm just going to go over then some of the things that we do that you all may not know about. We're kind of the best kept secret. The building was created and, the year now. It's actually in the PowerPoint slides. But it was created, health districts were created after the 1919 flu. Our building was built in '83 for 34 people. and we have 75 employees now. We're kind of divided into three groups or divisions. We have the vital statistics division, where the birth and death certificates are. And one thing that's new with birth and death certificates now is that you can get them online, and you can get them in any place that you've lived or any place that you're born. So you do not have to go to the county that you're born in anymore in Ohio. You can get the whole thing online. It's $24, and so people like that a whole lot better. You can come in though and see the awesome old books that are signed in the fountain ink. So interesting. Community Health Services is the I'm the director of that division, and in that we have all the clinics. They're operated by the physicians and the nurses. We have a reproductive health program. We have immunizations for children and adults. We have an overseas travel clinic in case anybody wants to take an anxiety trip or go on a mission trip. We still have a prenatal clinic and a well child clinic. And we have a WIC program. Over 3,000 women in Greene County are on the Women, Infant, and Children program. And we have case management, two nurses that case manage what's called the Bureau for Children with Medical Handicaps. And that's a program where while a child's being diagnosed with even a developmental delay all the way to a medically fragile situation, that program that the state has can pay for co-pays or insurances or certain surgeries that may be required or treatments for certain diagnoses. We have a dental clinic, the Safety Net Dental Clinic. That's sort of the best kept secret. We operate that 3 days a week, hygiene and dentistry. We have Help Me Grow under the health district now, and that's for children births to three to receive early intervention services if needed. We have the HIV health education tests and counsels. We have a lead poisoning prevention program, TB program. The county commissioners actually give money towards that TB program. That's a mandate. And I think I mentioned we still have a prenatal clinic. And then that's kind of all of community health services. In addition to some population-based services that we're doing a backpack program with one of the schools and helping to pack up food on Fridays to send backpacks home with the kids so they have something that they can eat, open themselves and eat through the weekend if they need. We also have an awesome program through a state grant that's called Baby and Me Tobacco Free. We have a tobacco cessation counselor now. If the women promise to be tobacco free for the time that they're pregnant, and then we test them with an analyzer, they'll receive free diapers every month for the first year of the child. So we're doing some more of those kind of population-based services now that we see. In environmental health, if we don't hear anything bad in the community, then the environmental health inspectors are doing their jobs, because they inspect every restaurant, every campground, every school cafeteria, every tattoo parlor, to make sure there's stereotyping going on there. They inspect all the public pools that we have. We have 129 in Greene County. They investigate animal bites, so we have a rabies control unit, and do nuisance complaints, do plumbing inspections for new commercial development and new homes. And then we have a sewage treatment system, solid waste program, and water sample collection and water systems for private people too if they want to put in wells. And then we, with health education, will come and talk to anybody who wants to talk about any subject or educate any group on anything they'd like to know, inform and educate. We're starting a program coming up for balance for seniors for falls prevention. It's very important as we get older. Healthy Lifestyles Coalition, we have, and we're doing a lot of work on infant mortality also with a lot of our other community partners going forward. We have a grant we wrote with OSU Extension in Greene County recently for a prenatal advocate to kind of come along beside the women to help them so that they're making their appointments, they're going back to their postpartum appointment, they are connecting to what they need. They have food, they have furniture, they have a crib, and baby pumps. So the most of our income comes from our revenue. We've increased our Medicaid revenue significantly this year because we have someone positioned in the health district that helps the clients get on the Affordable Care Act. So we have increased income from Medicaid. We have grant money, but each year, and we've been told this by the state, the grants will be dwindling at 6%, and they have hit us tremendously in that way. And then we have the tax levy. And the tax levy is 34% of our budget. It is a renewal. It's a five-year renewal, a 0.8 mil operating levy, which is $24.50 a year for a $100,000 home value. So we do have a PowerPoint that I think that...
It got in our packet. So it's in our packet, which means it's out to the public. So it's a public document.
I just wanted to hit the highlights of my cheat sheet here. And I have these issue 9 cards that we created with just some kind of down and dirty bullet points.
Maybe if you could put on the table outside, and then that way Judy could distribute them. We can make sure that they get distributed.
Okay. And are there any questions at all? I'm not going to answer anything.
We've worked with you all on the mosquito program, on environmental. So that's been, we worked with Debbie Leopold on that. So that's been, that was very helpful. So we definitely do work with Greene County. Public health.
Mm-hmm.
We appreciate your work. Thank you.
Thanks.
I realize we did not put citizens' concerns on this agenda, so I will, before we move on to the work session, we will ask if there are concerns about items that are not on the agenda. Keep your comments to 3 minutes, and you need to come up to the front and state your name. Yes, ma'am.
It's the big one. It's just not really loud in your ear.
My name's Teresa Gill, and I moved here a couple months. I've been here for a couple months. And is there, can the village help me to get African-American products at Dollar General?
Get African-American products at Dollar General?
They don't have African-American here.
Normally that's not something that the village would get involved in. Have you spoken to the manager there about it?
Yeah, they gave me the district.
Okay.
The manager, I called it and let the, he never called back.
Oh.
But I kind of tried to start a discussion on it. Yeah, I was praying. That didn't go over too well.
Yeah.
It didn't go over well.
Well,
It didn't go over well. So I just thought to come here, but I thought the village... I thought they just didn't know, and a lot of people didn't know.
Yeah.
People of color, that was just like,
yeah,
I felt reserved to ask to have that parity. I don't know, but white, I mean, people were white, we didn't know. They were like, we don't shop for those things.
Yeah.
So it seemed like they were willing to do, people in power would be willing to do something.
Well, unfortunately, we don't usually, as a government, tell people who own businesses what they have to stock. Karen, do you
know
of any other
actually,
spots?
I could see bringing this to HRC, and I don't know whether, I'm not, at least as a discussion, no, we don't tell people what to stock, mm-hmm. but we can encourage, stores to stock certain things, and it seems to me it would make sense.
Mm-hmm.
So I will be happy, and if you're interested, you can come to the Human Relations Commission meeting, mm-hmm. which is
the first Thursday of the month at 7.
So
it's the 5th.
The 5th?
Yep.
The 5th of November in this room at 7 o'clock. And I will request that these be put on the agenda.
Thanks, Mary Ann.
Second question. Today, I was trying to get a clear understanding with the about the ordinance because of disconnect, because I was in jeopardy being disconnected today. And Melissa believes that the part of the ordinance in the 104.04, I want to say, and there's probably more because she says she knows them in and out, but I read it for me to understand that I could make it one day. I have one day to make it.
And you are at 3 minutes, just to let you know.
Okay. Okay. Well, that's okay. Just finish this.
And then I had a day to make an appeal. I just want clarity on, do I have the day? Because her understanding is that I don't. But she kind of said, because you're going to do this. I'm not asking, but I'm not free. I'm asking, do I have the day? Because they started me Friday, and the disconnect was for Monday, and they were adamant about 48 hours. Can we consider the 48 hours to be 48 business days? 48-hour days is open to business, because the hours at the village is kind of really, for working people, is a little tricky. And I just wanted 48. I had no time between Friday and Monday to talk, to dialogue with the village, dialogue with the utility company or find resources, but I did start to
talk Tuesday.
Okay, it's... if I understand your question correctly, you're asking, since you got a letter on Friday, would you have had until today to file an appeal? Is that correct? But you, if I'm understanding, we're already on a payment plan.
It seems like this is something that should probably be handled by staff.
Yeah.
And
how about if you
can
wait for a few minutes after the meeting, I'll be happy to talk to you about it.
You would?
Yeah.
Because it said I can appeal all day. I'm not a day
to not it's only under circumstances different than yours, and I can explain that if you give me
okay.
a minute.
Okay. Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Not on the agenda. So I'm going to suggest that I see our illustrious staff sitting here, so I'm suggesting that we go to the budget next so that we can then, those folks can leave if they would like. So we will turn the meeting over to finance director and assistant. Are you finance director anymore? Are you assistant village manager?
She's both things.
I know you are, but would we call you finance director? What
I'm
do we
not sure.
That? Okay.
I think I'm a slash.
Okay. So we're turning it over to Melissa Van Zandt to talk about enterprise, special revenue funds, and capital budgets.
Okay. It seems kind of loaded because there's so many different budgets, but what we'll start with is we'll start with our special revenue funds, and this kind of tied in with the general fund budget discussion that we had the last meeting, because the special revenue funds, as indicated by title, they only receive revenues from limited sources. The bulk of the revenues that come into these funds are via transfers from the general fund. So when we talked about the general fund, we talked about some of the transfers and going out to these various special revenue funds to support them. Because, for example, streets, they are supported by some gasoline taxes, motor vehicle license taxes. They're very minimal, and that it's not enough to support the entire operation. As well as our parks, we received some revenues from program receipts, rentals of the various facilities, as well as swimming pool admissions and concessions and such. Again, very limited amount of money to support the operation as a whole. So when we talk about special revenue funds, you just have to keep in mind that most of the revenue is transfers in from those general funds again. I'm going to go ahead and give just kind of an overall of the special revenue funds. If we flip to the very back page, page 11 of 11, it has the bottom line of the special revenue funds as a whole. And we're going to dip into our reserves by approximately $180,000. Every year we're in the black because what the past practice has been is we've transferred enough money in to make sure that those revenues meet those expenses with those general fund transfers. And with expenditures over the past couple of years coming in a little bit lower than projected or budgeted, those special revenue funds were able to build up a little bit of a balance. So what I've done is I've reduced the amount of some of those transfers in order to be able to keep some more money into the general fund and still leave enough reserves in the special revenue funds that would adequately cover what would be needed should something occur where we wouldn't have any more revenue that came into and we would still have enough for 4 months of operating cost. So we'll go ahead and we'll start out with streets. They get approximately just about $100,000 a year in the gasoline and the motor vehicle license taxes. It's kind of tapered down over the years if you look at the trends from the 2013, 2014 actuals and then what's projected for this year and then again in 16. So those have kind of tapered down a little bit. So the operation only received the streets operation only receives about $118,000 worth of revenues that come in. So the rest of that is made up with the transfer. So if you take a look at the transfers in, we're going to transfer about $170,000 less this year than what we have in the past to kind of draw down some of those reserves. And then if we look at the actual expenditures, the expenditures for streets next year are going to come in at just barely under $100,000 lower than what was budgeted in 15. And they're also on track to spend about $100,000 less than what was budgeted as well. So the 2016 budget when it comes to streets was put to be more in line with what was going to be spent or anticipated to be spent in 2015. So if you take a look at streets at that blue bar on page 2 at the very bottom, it's got that we're spending into reserves about $156,000. And we need about $230,000 in reserves that would cover 4 months of operating. And at the end of the year, if we spend every single penny that we budget for, which historically we spend a little bit less than what we budget for, we'll have about $244,000 end of year reserves, which are just $14,000 higher than what we really need. So streets is looking like it's in pretty good shape. So does anybody have any questions about what we did there?
Under personnel services, it seems like it's a fairly big jump from last year.
It's actually $4,000 less than last year.
Okay, I'm looking under the budgeted for 2015 compared to 2016 under streets personnel services.
Yeah, it's $4,000 less than budgeted in 15.
Oh, I mean actual, projected.
Oh, the projected?
Yeah.
Yeah, we did have quite a bit of savings there. If you remember back from the general fund, the personnel line is something that I try to brace for, I shouldn't call it the worst, but if everybody was to receive a raise, if everybody was to receive a step increase, their longevity pay, a 2% increase, everybody remains on the health care as is, it's padded a little bit.
I see, yeah. I was comparing it to the what might be the actual.
Yeah, the actuals will always come in a little bit less just because I like to kind of brace for the worst.
Okay.
Because you have little flexibility when it comes to the personnel line. With all the other lines in the budget below that, you can kind of move money from one line to another. But when it comes to personnel, I try to get it right the first time so that we don't have to go back. So I pad it a little bit every year.
Okay, thanks, and Melissa.
Yeah, one of the things that did change in personnel last year, not for streets, but for the Bryan Center, was that we had some employees go on to the insurance when council made that minimal change for part-time employees last year.
Yeah, I saw that.
So yeah, we'll notice that there was a bit of a jump because of employees electing health insurance that hadn't previously. Okay. So streets is on track to spend less than budgeted this year, and they are also being budgeted less than what they were in 15, again in 16. If we look at the State Highway Maintenance Fund, this is some gasoline and motor vehicle license taxes that are earmarked for the state highway, which is State Route 68 that goes through the middle of town, Xenia Avenue. We haven't spent money out of these funds. As you can see, nothing in 13, nothing in 14. And in 2015, since we had a little bit of reserve there, the electric superintendent, Johnny Burns, had suggested that we put some battery backups on the street lights that are on those major roads, which would be Dayton Street, as well as Xenia Avenue.
The traffic lights, the traffic control lights.
Yeah, traffic control lights to have battery backups in case we have a power outage. So you'll see that there's an expenditure of $17,250 projected in 2015. Mm-hmm. Those would cover the battery backups for Xenia Avenue. And then, again, we'll see in the permissive tax fund, a couple of pages down, we've got the exact same amount allocated there, where we were going to do the exact same thing on Dayton Street as well. So we're going to spend into that little bit of a fund that had started to build up there by a minimal amount. Okay, so Parks and Recreation Fund, again, this is kind of like streets. The majority of the money, like I said, comes from program receipts, swimming pool admissions, rentals for the gym, Bryan Center gym, and other facilities. They only bring in about $50,000 a year, and the operation costs almost six times that. So again, it's supported with a transfer in from the general fund. I've got approximately $80,000 less being transferred in to the parks fund so that we can kind of spend down again on reserves and still keep us within our safe range. So the Parks and Rec Fund, though, actually has quite a few departments that are underneath of it. The actual Parks Department, we've got the pool, we've got the Bryan Center, the Bryan Youth Center, and that's it for those. So each of those departments are under budget, with the exception of the pool, just because what we did was we took the same amount of our Dayton pool management contract and we divided it between personnel and operating. Since the pool management will be taken back in-house, and historically when we had taken the pool management or had the pool management in-house, it had actually saved us money versus the Dayton pool management contract. So trying to predict exactly how much that's going to cost next year, since we haven't had it in-house in a couple of years, Dayton Pool Management has been with us for 2 years, it's going to be kind of hard to gauge at first, so we're just kind of taking our best educated guess at it's probably going to cost about as much as our contract did, but it could come in a little bit lower.
I think, I'm not sure, and I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about it, but I don't know that council was actually aware of this, that this is a proposal that staff was going to make to council.
Yeah.
Actually, I thought it was going to happen this year.
Yeah.
So, but it,
Sam
it,
was
they,
training
that
this
proposal
year
was
to
made.
Do it. Yeah, to do it next
okay.
year.
Yeah, we had to wait for the training.
So the bottom line with the parks budgets is they're going to dip into reserves a little bit just because of that transfer, but the majority of the departments are coming in a little bit less, with the exception of the Bryan Center, and that was what we were referring to earlier in the personnel line. It's about $30,000 higher because of the, or $20,000 higher, I'm sorry, because of the health insurance elections of employees that didn't previously have health insurance. So we'll also have a supplemental appropriation for that this year as well, because they had elected to have that health insurance benefit this year. Does anybody have any questions about the parks? At the end of the year, we should have approximately $118,000 that are recommended to be in our reserves. And if we spend everything that we are budgeting for 2016, we'll end the year at $121,000 in reserves, which is just slightly higher than what we need. Okay, so if nobody has any question on parks, we've got a lot of relatively minimally used funds next. Economic Development Fund, I don't have anything appropriated there. We haven't had anything appropriated there for quite a while. That may be a fund that I understand might get tapped into, but at this point, there wasn't any plan to tap into it from the discussions that I'd had with other staff. So that could always be a supplemental appropriation should there be a plan come into fruition in 2016.
I have a question. Oh, two. One, Denise Swinger is going to be spending part of her time in economic development. Is that not right?
Mm-hmm.
So wouldn't there be some, shouldn't there be some personnel costs attached to that?
Well, I mean, we could either attach them there or just leave them in planning and use part of the planning funds for the economic development. That may be something we look at doing in the future, is changing it over to be it, but it would just simply shift part of her salary from one to the other. Mm-hmm. So her salary is right now reflected in the planning line, and it could be
in administration.
Yeah, in administration under my department. So it could be moved over there in the future, yes, if that's something that we,
okay,
because we are going to be moving towards that, yes.
The other question was, Karen, I thought I remembered you suggesting a study to be done about properties in town, mm-hmm, that could
available
be
properties,
business locations.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know whether we want to set aside any money for that, or is it already in a place that could be used?
Well, that would be probably a consultant that would do that and create a small snapshot of each property that you would have available to folks looking for land. That could either come out of the planning under professional services or under my administrative under professional services. So again, yes, okay, we could put it here if that's what council would like to do, mm-hmm, certainly.
It does have a fund balance of $121,000. And it doesn't receive any income from any other source. It's just a separate fund, basically so that we can monitor money that's spent in that area. So any money that comes into the economic development fund would be a transfer from the general fund anyways.
Yeah.
So we could certainly appropriate money out of that area if that's something the council would want to do.
Well, I mean, it sounds like it works at least for this year because we're moving into that direction. Mm-hmm. We don't know,
right,
what would
well and what I would prefer if it were if it you know if it is Denise that we're paying part of the salary is to maybe wait a year until we see
how much
what her time is. I mean, how much time she's spending in planning and zoning, and then how much time she's able to spend in economic development. Mm-hmm. And I do think that the study is easily paid for out of planning. I mean, it's as much of a planning exercise as it is an economic development exercise. So at this point, you know, I say let's leave that fund and just keep it where it is.
Yeah, that actually might be a fund to increase in line items as the Economic Sustainability Commission gets up and moving again.
Mm-hmm.
But
okay, thanks.
And the good thing about the budget is that, like this year, we will have done two supplemental appropriations by the end of the year. So if there's ever anything that we need to circle back around to and make changes to in regards to the budget, then there's always one opportunity to do that, and there's usually two, just depending on the year. Okay, we have the Green Space Fund next, and as a result of the conversation at the last budget meeting, we have a $25,000 transfer coming in from the general fund that council had talked about. And I didn't appropriate any expenditures because there weren't any projects that I was aware of. So if somebody knows of a project that I'm not aware of, I can always appropriate money if need be in that fund. We'll move on to the permissive tax fund. Again, this is where we get some small motor vehicle registrations and gasoline taxes in each year. And that's where we've got the Dayton Street battery backups for the traffic lights coming out of. That fund that's been unused for the last couple of years. Next, we have Mayor's Court Computer Fund. A portion of the fines that come into the Mayor's Court are earmarked for the computer fund. It's a very small amount of money, and it basically covers their software program that they use in that office. So that's the Mayor's Court Computer Fund. Law Enforcement and Education Fund. This is a relatively inactive fund just because there's very little amount of money that comes into this each year. This money comes from the Xenia Municipal Court. It's kind of hit or miss in terms of what we get. It's got projected to have a $4,000 fund balance, so should the police department want to tap into that for any kind of a training, they could certainly do that, but there's nothing on the radar for 2016, and it's a relatively unused fund, as you can see. The next one is the Coats and Supplies Fund. This one is kind of, I kind of underestimate what we're going to bring in, and I kind of just go by what's been spent in the past in terms of expenditures, so that fluctuates from year to year. As you can see, how much money we bring in. In 2013 we had $3,900, and then in 2014 we brought in $7,600, which was huge. So that fund has quite a cushion in it. It's got we started out the year with $10,600 in that fund, and we usually spend about $3,000 a year out of that fund as well. So some years it's a little heavier when it gets built up, but some years it's a little bit lighter. Just depends on the needs in the community.
And those are revenues that we, a lot of those revenues are donated.
Pure donations.
From citizen
100%
donations.
Pure donation. Okay, mm-hmm. Okay, we have federal forfeited assets. As you all may remember, this used to be called, now I can't remember what it was called before, it used to be called the FOJ Fund, and it had federal and state monies commingling, which are a big no-no. So that was one of the things I was tasked with when I started, was trying to separate all that stuff out and figure out what was federally seized money and what was state seized money. Ooh.
That was interesting.
What in the world was that?
Judy, did you touch it?
So basically, you'll see that we have two funds. We have federal forfeited assets and we have state law enforcement trust fund. We receive very little in terms of federal dollars. As you'll see, there's been nothing that's came in, but we do have $3,200 in that fund that has been there for quite a while. So I've got that fund as relatively inactive currently. The state law enforcement trust fund, however, That's the fund where a lot of the state seizure money comes into, and that's also where you'll notice that we pay for our membership out to the ACE Task Force in the amount of $10,500 every year, which you see that expenditure. And then the materials and supplies are used for various things in which the PD needs throughout the year that they are able to spend out of that fund. This year we're expected to have a fund balance at the end of the year of $70,000, so that provides the PD with a little bit of cushion for any kind of equipment that they might need that they didn't have budgeted for in their regular budget. And the last fund that we have is the Police Pension Fund. This is a state mandated fund that we have set up. This is where our full-time police officer's pension is paid out of, and we receive a little bit of tax money that goes into this from the Greene County Auditor and our property taxes that are given to us twice a year. And the money that we need to make up for that is made by a transfer from the general fund. So that usually just zeroes out. I try to zero that out, kind of like with the streets and the parks approach that we had taken. So it's got a little bit of a fund balance in it, but nothing that's too exorbitant. So that is the special revenue funds. Does anybody have any questions about those? No? Okay. All right, the next one that we have are capital project and debt service funds. The capital projects are the capital improvement funds are something that we've had a lot of discussion about trying to rejuvenate. These have went relatively unused for a very, very long time. Some of them have fund balances, some of them do not. Cable has a $10,500 fund balance in it, and that money would be there should the cable access need any new equipment. I don't have anything that's earmarked for them to spend out of that area. Actually, most of these funds do not have anything to be expended out of them except for Parks and Rec. All of them just have money coming in. So this is going to tie to the enterprise funds. Water capital improvement, we don't have anything going into that just because we've got such major projects that we're trying to play catch-up with, as well as the water plant that everybody's aware of. So I don't have anything being transferred into that because we really need to build that fund up first before we start moving any money out of it. The sewer capital improvement fund, we earmarked $150,000 to begin with. So that money would be there for any projects that we would need access to additional funds from. The intention with all of these capital improvement budgets is that any of our capital projects would start to come out of these funds and not out of the operating budget, so that we've got very clear divisions between what it costs to operate a department versus what it costs to maintain the department in terms of capital projects.
And Melissa, just to clarify, so these are transfers in from the respective enterprise funds?
Correct.
Okay.
So when we go to look at the sewer fund, you'll see that there's going to be an expenditure of $150,000 as a transfer out.
Right.
And this is where it's being received in. We've got $500,000 coming into the electric capital improvement fund. The electric fund has historically carried a little bit of a cushion. This is just earmarking some of that money for capital. And if we turn over the Parks and Rec Improvement Fund, there's a grant that we would receive. Patty, you might be able to explain this a little bit more because it's been so long since we've talked about this. I don't fully remember what the grant deal was.
The NatureWorks grant?
Yes.
The NatureWorks grant was a 75-25 match for new playground equipment, and I did speak to Chris Bell Bednar about that a little bit on Saturday at the Rails to Trails Conservancy office opening. And she's going to check on to see what the timeline is for getting that new equipment in. But NatureWorks pays 75% of the cost and the village pays 25%. So I think our match is the 22.5, so we're going to get a whole new set of playground equipment for the Bryan Center playground out here for that amount. Three pieces, Jason?
Two pieces. So we do have a little bit of money coming in from that grant, and we also have a transfer in of $50,000 that's coming from the general fund that we spoke about at the last meeting. Facilities and improvement fund, there's a transfer in for $50,000 because that fund will have been almost completely depleted at the end of this year because of the library roof replacement. So we've got $50,000 coming into that from the general fund as well. And then capital equipment fund, we've got $50,000 coming into that. And that's just a very general account, or a very general fund, not necessarily tied to any specific department should we need it. And then we also still have out there the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers grant. That fund is still in existence, even though it's been relatively inactive, just because that grant is still open. So I kept it on there just so that it's still on everyone's radar in terms of being in existence still. So if we turn over to the back page, we have the OPWC loop completion grant. And that was where we received $400,000 from OPWC funds. And then we had a transfer in of $405,000 from the general fund that came into that to pay down that project. So we've got the money coming in and the exact same amount coming out, so that grant will be zeroed out at the end of the year.
And we also applied for the $405,000 loan from OWBA that Melissa did get back for that, the other part of that project. So
we do have a loan for that, which all of those debt service payments will be in the enterprise funds that you guys will see. And then we've got a bond retirement fund that's been inactive for some time. It carried the Bryan Center debt, and then the electric fund paid for the Bryan Center debt, and so now that's an inactive fund. So it's there just because there was activity in 2013, but next year I'll drop it off of the radar because it won't be active. Okay, so the very last budgets that we have to go over are the enterprise funds. And I did do a five-year projection of the enterprise funds with all of the recommended rate increases from the rate studies. So there is kind of a Reader's Digest version of the 2016 and beyond, which we'll kind of wrap back around to, but I just wanted to point out that there is a five-year projection that I did include. Okay, so the enterprise fund budget, if you look at the actual budget, we've got the front page here, and this is the Reader's Digest version. In the pink at the top, it says what where the fund should, each of the funds began. It shows the revenues and the expenditures for the year, and then it shows whether each of those budgets are projected to go to carry a deficit or surplus, and then it also shows what the effect on the bottom line fund balance is, and then that carries up to the next year in 2016, and then the same thing, projected revenues, expenses, and then any surplus or deficit, and then projected end of year balance for 16. So if you take a look at these budgets on this page, we're expected to have surpluses in all of the funds except for the electric fund, which has a fund balance that's able to sustain the very minimal $39,000 deficit in which it's going to have for the year. So it should end the year at a $2.6 million fund balance. And then we did plan for an 18% increase in the electric fund. John Courtney's presentation recommended a 21% increase. And when I had done the tax budget, I had a 15% increase in there. So that was before John Courtney's presentation. And then after going over all of this and speaking to Patty about it, we budgeted for an 18% increase in 2016. And once we get into the electric fund a little more in depth, we've got a pretty significant jump in our power cost that's going to occur in 2016, so we need to try to brace for that. But one thing I want to point out before we get into the electric budget is it looks like there's a really huge deficit in 2016. $500,000 of that is moving money out to that electric improvement fund, so we're only projected to have a $250,000 deficit in the electric fund. So we'll go ahead and we'll look at the electric fund a little bit more in depth. This year we're on track to bring in about $500,000 more in revenue than what we were budgeted for, which is pretty good. That does also include an advance in from the general fund to finish paying off that Bryan Center debt. And the very last payment that the general fund has to make to the electric payment occurs in 2016, so we will no longer have that additional $70,000 coming in. So I do have the rate increase in there at 18%, and then there's just very minimal amounts of money that come in from miscellaneous receipts and reimbursements. So the majority of the money that comes into that fund is from the consumer fees coming in from as a direct result of the rates. So 2016, I'm projecting with the rate increase that we will bring in about $500,000 more than what we are projected to bring in at the end of 2015. And then if we get into the expenditures are on track this year to be about $400,000 lower than what were budgeted. However, in 2016, if we take a look, the most significant expenditure line that we have is the contractual services, and you'll see that that's jumping up about $900,000, and that's a direct result of the figures that AMP gave us from the anticipated power cost that we should expect in 2016. I don't know. Was that distributed to council, Patty? I can't remember. No, I know I have seen that.
We just got it. What was it? Thursday or Friday of last week?
Yeah.
And is that reflecting the higher cost of the hydro? Is that the reason?
Actually, no. It's the market right now. Huh. So the hydro will actually increase probably those costs even more. I mean, it reflects. I think it reflects one of the plants. Johnny, did you look at that? It reflects one of the plants, but not the other two.
Now, some of those higher power costs, most of them do get passed on to the customer, though, through the power cost adjustment. The electric rates are just a very complex, tricky calculation. There's so many factors that are involved in it, but there is a power cost adjustment each month that's calculated by John Courtney and attached as part of each customer's bill to account for power costs as they fluctuate throughout the year.
The customer is our citizens and businesses.
Correct. So even though we're going to have about a $400,000 savings in the electric fund versus what was budgeted in 2015, we are anticipating that our budget's going to go up quite a bit in 2016 to brace for those power costs that are increasing. So everything else, though, there wasn't anything really notable except for those power costs. Does anybody have any questions about the electric fund?
And we will be talking a little bit later on in my report about rate structures.
I guess I have a question, which is not really about our budget. What's happening in the market, do you know, that's causing the increase?
They didn't really give a full explanation of it. They just said this is what the rates are going to be. They buy power on the open market for three years in advance. So a lot of it's a speculative price, but.
And it may lower with the actual costs?
It may, the actual cost may be lower, but they're usually pretty accurate.
A lot of coal plants are closing. And so I'm guessing that is a conversion to higher cost. New plants is probably part of what's causing it.
It could be.
Okay, so we're gonna go back to that very first page. We're gonna take a look at the water fund. At the beginning of 2015, we started the year with $188,000 fund balance, which is a lot lower than what the recommended reserve is. Based on our average operating, we should have about $316,000 in our reserves. At the end of the year, we are set to have a surplus of approximately $44,000, which means that in 2016, we would start out with a beginning balance of $232,000, which is still short of that recommended reserve. I do have included in there the 30% increase, which has been brought before council in legislation at the last meeting and will come again at the next meeting. So at the end of the year, we would have a surplus of $78,016, which would bring us up to $311,000. So if we flip to the page that has the water fund on it, that would be page 5. Okay, we've got our revenues. Our consumer fees are including that 15% increase. And then we receive just very small amounts in miscellaneous revenue.
That was 30% increase.
Yeah, it was a 30% increase.
Yeah.
Yours says 30%, right? No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't.
I know. I caught that, and I changed it, and I must have sent over the wrong one. Oh, I did. I redid it, and I sent it over the wrong one. Made it in.
So is the number correct? It's just the
number is correct.
Okay.
Yes. Because I've got it here. Yeah, the number is correct. Mm-hmm. I had sent another one over, and I know that Judy was having a lot of copier issues.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to double check that I have the spreadsheet here. I just want to make sure. I know that I went back and I looked at it. Water, 787.
Yeah, there it is right
there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. The figure is right. It's just the notation off to the right is incorrect in this copy. You'll notice that in 2015, though, there were some strange things that happened. We did have a reimbursement coming into the water fund, which we weren't sure when we were going to get those OPWC funds. That loan was receipted into the water fund. So we do have that's there. And I had it being receipted into the grant fund, and that's actually probably where it should have went, but I need to fix that, honestly. I just now noticed that. But anyways, we've got we've got that money that came in to OPWC that I did receipt into the water fund, which I need to receipt into the grant fund. And I've got it documented over there. I had it documented in two places now that I'm realizing that. Okay. So then when it comes to expenditures, we did have some cost savings in terms of personnel, but we did have some changes in personnel, which were a result of those, which are a result of those cost savings there. So everything else remained pretty close to what had been budgeted in previous years, with the exception of the debt service line, which is down near the bottom of the page. That's got money allocated in 2016 for loan repayments for the loop and the bottleneck loans, as well as an existing loan that we had. There was a distribution loan that we had, an OWDA loan for, that's an older loan. So you'll notice the debt service line jumped quite a bit, but we also took on two different loans that we expect to begin repayment of in 2016. It was just a partial for one of the loans, and then it was a full amount for another loan. But the timing of all of that, we still need to figure out in terms of at least the bottleneck elimination loan. That was kind of speculation in terms of when the first payment would be due on that. So other than that, that was water distribution. And then if we look down at water treatment, we didn't really have a whole lot of changes in terms of personnel. Again, those budgets are a little padded. We were going to see some salary savings in 2015, but we did have some personnel changes. Let's see. We had some higher expenditures in 2015 that you'll notice, because we did have part of the water plant consultant, which we had a conversation about that, Patty and I do need to allocate some more money for 2016 for the rest of that contract, because I don't have that in there.
Right.
I had in my head that the consultant was just the money that we transferred in from the general fund, but that was only half of it, because we were only bracing for what would occur in 15 and not in 16. So I will need to update the 2016 budget contractual services to include the other half of the consultant fee. And that happened at 0:30 on Friday after this was already to Judy.
So that's an additional $225,000 in the
correct
transfers line.
It's slightly less.
Well,
than that, but yes.
We're not really sure what we're going to do in terms of. We've got the money in the, it's going to have to be a transfer.
It's going to have to be a transfer, and it'll also be part of what we apply to OWDA for to get back as part of the loan.
Although it's probably not the full amount, because their contract will extend on through 2017, I'm assuming.
It will.
So it's not going to be the full.
So it'll, correct. Yeah, we'll have to take a look at that and try to figure out what would be appropriate to allocate in 2016, and then what would be appropriate in 2017.
Yeah, because they do stay on through the warranty period.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, and construction won't be done until late 17 anyway.
Okay, so let's see. That was contractual services, materials and supplies stayed the same. We don't have any debt service in terms of water treatment as of yet. So we've got a surplus for water treatment. The expenses totaled $718,000 for 2016 collectively, giving us a surplus of approximately $78,000 at the end of the year if all goes well. But then again, though, we're going to have to allocate some more money for the consultant, so we need to do that. Let's see. Okay, does anybody have any questions about water? Okay, we're going to move on to sewer. I do have a 15% increase in there, which was Wayne Cannon's recommendation. So that is reflected in our charges for service. And then again, we just have small amounts that come into the miscellaneous receipts and reimbursements. Sewer collection, our expenditures are going to be slightly less than what we had budgeted in 2015, because we're on track to save a little bit. Our expenditures in 2016 are a little less than what we're budgeted in 2015, and our projections are a little bit less as well. Training has stayed the same, which are our general operating expenses. Our contractual services are relatively the same, just about $1,000 or a little bit less more. Materials and supplies, basically the same, just slightly less. And then what we have next are debt service, which is the jet back truck lease. Miscellaneous, we have refunds and reimbursements. It had been a little bit higher in previous years because the sewer fund had a loan repayment of about $12,000 and some that was going to the general fund from a project on Cemetery Street from the 80s. And the last repayment, or the last payment, was due in 2015, so that would be over with. So those expenditures are lower since that debt would be paid off. And then we've got an advance out of $75,000, or a transfer out, I'm sorry, of $75,000 that's going to the improvement fund. What I did was I split half of it between sewer collection and half of it between sewer treatment. So you'll see two different transfers out, one in each of the budgets. So if we look at the bottom line of the sewer collection expenses, they are approximately $100,000 higher, but part of that is a $75,000 transfer out to that capital improvement fund.
And Melissa, just to clarify, so actually the recommended increase for sewer is 30%, right?
No.
It's 15.
It's 15. Water was 30.
Water was 30 for three years.
It's not
years.
The other way around?
No.
Because when I look at these numbers, all right.
Yeah. Water was, and the reason, Brian, I think, was because the sewer plant is way newer than the water plant. So while you have continued maintenance, and we do have maintenance to do on the collection system, but most of the infrastructure at the plant is newer.
No, Brian is right. That figure that's in there.
I'm pretty sure.
Early on, we referenced that.
It's a 30%. That was a 30% increase.
The numbers are accurate because I just did the calculation in my head, but we just need to flip the notes.
No, Wayne's recommendation was 30 on water and 15 on sewer.
The calculation I had in there for sewer is 30% that was in front of them. That figure actually should be... The bottom line for charges for services should be $885,438.
Okay. So the number is not correct.
It's not.
$885,438. You have Wayne's thing in your bag.
For charges for service, yep. This budget was a challenging one this year, I'm going to tell you that, with all the changes that have been made. 884. So the bottom line is actually 890. 238 is the total sewer revenue. And then what that does to the bottom line, if we flip back to the front page, sewer's going to run a deficit of 107. 857, even with the 15% increase.
Yeah. These numbers are not.
Which makes me wonder if what we should do is back off that transfer out to the capital improvement fund. Let's do that. Right now we've got $150,000 coming out. Maybe we should do
25 and 25. Yeah, make it a $50,000 instead of 150.
Okay, let me make that change.
So what we're doing is the transfer out to the capital improvement fund will be 25,000 to collection and 25,000 to treatment right now, instead of.
So it'll be a total on the sheet where you had showed that.
I'll give you the updated total to update that front page. Which is part of the reason why I brought the laptop, so if I needed to make changes on the fly, I could. Okay, so now the deficit at the end of the year, changing that rate increase and changing those transfers will be $7,800. We will have a reserve balance of $315,000 at the end of 2016, and our recommended reserve is only $295,000, so we would still end the year with enough cushion in order to maintain adequate reserves. So again, with sewer, if we look at that front page, our revenues would be $890,238. Our expenditures would be $898,095 with a reserve, or I'm sorry, a deficit of $7,857. Projected year-end fund balance of in 2016 would be $315,791, which would be the figure underneath the $7,800 deficit.
So what was the, what were the revenues again, Melissa?
$890,238.
What were the expenditures?
$898,095.
Okay. So this will be when we get the final budget.
Correct. Yeah.
This will be all
correct.
Cleared up. Okay.
Yep. Okay. So let's see.
Solid waste.
Yes. Well, sewer treatment.
We fixed the water number, right? Because
yeah, the water, the number was correct.
The number was correct. It was the note.
The notation to the side was wrong.
Because when I did the tax budget, I had had a 15% increase for all of the funds, so that note didn't get updated, but the figure, the calculation was correct.
So, and just to be, so we're doing 30% off of 648 to get a final number for water?
Let me flip to that page.
I wouldn't think so. I wouldn't think that it was straight across the board, but maybe it is.
That's how I got the other number for sewer.
Well, but don't forget that there's readiness for service fees in that 648 that aren't changing.
Correct.
Okay, what I did with the water was I took what we are projected to bring in 2015, which would be $605,723 in consumer fees.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I used to add the 30% to, because
okay.
that's more likely what's going to happen at the end of the year than what was budgeted.
Cool.
Except what I just said is, if we aren't, how much of the bills are readiness for service fees, and if we aren't increasing those, it seems like you may be projecting
a little bit higher,
too high.
I think percentage-wise on that, I mean, because it's a set fee for a certain number of users, I don't think.
I can take another look at that, Karen.
You can take the number of users times the readiness
yeah.
for service.
I mean, let's not do that now. But.
No, I can. I'll rerun that for the next presentation to see if it's going to have any kind of a major impact. I'm just going to write myself a note. Okay, so then, let's see, we went over sewer collection. We're going to go over sewer treatment. Let's see, 2015 is projected to come in a little bit lower than budgeted. Again, I padded for 2016 a little bit, as I usually do with personnel. Contractual services is about $20,000 less than in 15 that I have budgeted in 16. Materials and supplies, again, a little bit less than what was budgeted in 2015. Let's see, we don't have anything budgeted for capital at this point, although we will take a look, see if there's anything on the list. We do have debt service, which is obviously the wastewater treatment plant loan. And then we do have a transfer out, which we did reduce down to $25,000 for sewer treatment. Any questions about sewer? I know we tweaked that a little bit there. Okay. Solid waste, that's a pretty clear in and out. This year, it looks like we're going to add $15,000 to our surplus. I've got budgeted in 2016 that our expenses are going to fall just short of our revenues. I'm not really worried about it since there's so many rate increases happening with the other funds, and we've got a little bit of a fund balance in there to cover that. I would just go ahead and leave solid waste alone, but it's a clear in and out. Consumer fees and our contract to Rumpke. So we'll dip into our reserves a little bit, but it's got enough to be able to sustain.
Since the reason that fund seems to get in the red sometimes is because I'm assuming because of general village services and cleanup that they do, that we aren't passing along to consumers?
The village did start paying its own
okay.
garbage.
So they are, okay.
We
That's
do.
What I was going to ask.
The
okay.
big thing is cleanup week. That's about a $7,000 expense every year that the village absorbs. So that's part of the driver, is because we don't really have a way of paying for that. I know that in, was it 2014 and 20, or maybe it was 2015, the general fund paid for the village cleanup week, but we didn't account for that in 2016.
Okay.
But yeah, the cleanup week is kind of pricey. So the next thing we'll look at is the enterprise fund budget projections. I'm going to have to update this since the sewer fund is a little off. But you can, at least in terms of the expenditures with the sewer fund, you can see where those all should be solid. It's just the revenues were overstated in 2016, and then that would have carried forward since that beginning rate increase was wrong. But it does have out to the side of each of the funds the proposed rate increase, the rate increases. And these are what John Courtney, at least the electric, was what John Courtney had given us. And Patty and I kind of tweaked it a little bit.
These are slightly lower than.
Well, if you add them all up, they add up to the same amount of rate increase. But we just distributed them a little bit differently, like 18% in 2016. He recommended 21. I do have his recommendations here with me, just so that you can see the difference. We tried to soften the blow a little bit. He recommended 21.5% in 16. We recommended 18. He recommended 8.88 in 2017, and we recommended 12. In 2018, it was 9.2, we did 9, and then in 2018, it was 7.72, and we did 8. So we did change those a little bit, and then in 2020, 3%, because that's where it was going to level off. So electric should be fairly accurate. We've still got some pretty significant transfers going out to that capital fund. Approximately, let's see, the kilowatt hour transfer is in there, and then $100,000 out to the capital improvement fund every year. So you'll see that's a pretty accurate picture of what will happen with the electric fund if those rate increases are something that council decides to move forward with. Water should be a pretty accurate projection of what's going to happen with all of the rate increases, as you can see off to the side that Wayne Cannon proposed. Sewer is going to change a little bit, but those rate increase percentages are correct. It's just that very first total is going to go down a little bit, and it's going to trickle down and affect the rest. And then solid waste, I had put a recommended 3% annual rate increase starting in 2017, just to kind of level off those revenues and expenditures.
Okay.
The last thing that we have is the capital budget for 2016. This is a very brief document. The police department is requesting a new cruiser. They have not had one, I believe, since 2013. I think that's correct. They didn't have one in 14. They didn't get one in 15. So needless to say, they are due for a new cruiser. The street fund,
I have a question. Could I ask the chief? Mm-hmm. How many cruisers do we have, and what is there a policy of how often you trade them out, and what happens to the ones then that got traded off. Do we see any money back from that?
We currently have four marked cruisers. And what I proposed, and depending on how finances go in the future, you can either get on a 6-year or 8-year rotation so that you can plan on either replacing 4 cars in 6 years or 4 cars in 8 years. You can do 4 cars in 8 years. We do not put a lot of mileage on them here, but in year 7 and 8, you're going to incur more cost in repairs. So that's sort of what I have proposed, and I think mileage-wise and everything, we can do that.
And then what happens to the cars that we
When they're decommissioned, what we'll probably do, the one that gets decommissioned this year, we take the stickers off of, is what I will be driving when I have business purpose here at work. After that, then they'd be sold back out to the public.
So we would recoup some amount of money.
We would recoup some amount, yes.
The thing to remember about police cruisers is, while the village is small, they do get driven virtually every day. Somebody is going to drive a different, you know, the different cars every day because they're on the road 24/7. So they do consistently put miles on them. I mean, it's not like they're sitting on the weekends idle or something like that. And they do get driven on patrols consistently. So that's why you have to change them out consistently.
I guess, and this, I'm seeing I have some more questions. Is there any possibility of getting vehicles that have better gas mileage or vehicles that when they stop, well, like the sort of the Prius kind of thing, that when the car is not being driven but it's turned on, that the engine goes off? Is that?
Right now, there's nothing marketed in a police package like that. Part of it is the drain of all the equipment in the car between the radio, the computer, the in-car cameras,
the lights,
the wireless system. It is a large drain. A lot of police cruisers actually have an extra battery because of that, which is why you often see them running, because if you turn them off, you tend to drain the battery.
The
other thing about the mileage, a lot of what, because cruisers aren't driven long distances, mileage, although environmentally is a great thought, it's really not a fair marker, because often if I go out to a burglary and I'm at your house, I may drive 2 miles to your house, be there 45 minutes on report, sitting in the car, and drive 2 miles back. So mileage really is not a huge concern, especially in this village and in the distance that we travel.
But when, so I get what you're saying, all the equipment would drain
the battery
if you turn the engine off. So while cars are sitting, they are emitting whatever pollution and carbon dioxide.
Yes. And the whole idea of having the in-car computer is, instead of the officer coming back here and sitting in this building typing a report, he can go sit on Xenia Avenue or somewhere, type his report in the car. So number one, he's accessible to the citizens, and number two, even if he is not paying attention to the traffic, people who drive by believe he is. So the deterrent factors out there, and the idea is to have the cruisers and the police officers out in the neighborhoods, even when they're typing reports. So if they're at Gaunt Park typing a report, we at least know Gaunt Park has a police presence.
Yeah.
But it is a trade. It's a trade-off between draining the battery and the equipment versus the emissions that may be with the vehicle running.
Okay, you know, clearly the emissions is an issue, but again, when you start looking at the low emission cars, they're not police packages. If they ever were involved in a crash and they aren't have the police rating that the state big cars do, you may be looking at some liability issues also. There are certain cars that are marketed as police packages. They're what's known as pursuit rated. And interjecting a car in there that is not pursuit rated and an officer were to be hurt, it could hurt workers' comp. it could hurt other values and other costs.
I know there are efforts, anti-idling efforts, which would obviously be applicable here. You know, and I sense that there are groups, there are environmental groups that are working on this, recognizing that it's not, and there's not an easy solution to it, but recognizing that, you know, it's something that communities like us are interested in pursuing.
And I believe technology will get us there. You can turn the car off to some degree. I mean, there is, you know, they're made for some battery drain. After a while, one of the problems you have is the camera length long distance with the microphone. If it's off too long, that stops. The officer now starts the car, does something, although the camera will light up, you will not get the audio because you have to physically take the mic off, put it in a box, sync it with the camera in the car and put it back on. Well, if you're sitting there doing a report and something happens, you're not going to remember to do that. And then we're lacking the audio of that traffic stop, which sometimes is very valuable. So it is a balance. I understand the concerns. Right.
And I would ask, you know, that you would be open and working with Environmental Commission as things do, as technology does change, that we're just open to looking at options and opportunities that are not going to put our officers or the village safety at risk.
Right. And that's something I've actually already talked to the other three supervisors about.
Those three?
Is green vehicles, looking for green vehicles that would fit their uses, and in fact have a catalog on my desk about green vehicles.
Good.
So. Yeah, but we also have to understand that, you know, being that we're a small department, that we're not going to be able to keep up with the rapid change in technology, because we can't afford to swap out a car every year.
Right.
You know,
when technology is new, it's expensive.
That's right.
It becomes commonplace, the cost goes down for the average people. And clearly, you know, I believe it will come, and we'll just stay as current as we can with those things within the cost factor.
Right. Chief, the vehicle that you're replacing, is that the SUV?
No, it is actually one of the Chargers.
Okay.
We've had some issues with the Dodges. Brakes, it seems like there's a lot of maintenance cost.
Okay.
And then so we'll replace one of the Chargers, will come out of the
with what
charger.
A new Charger or something else?
No, I would move to go for an Expedition. And when you look at the miles per gallon that you're getting, the difference between a Charger and Expedition is about a mile or two a gallon. It's relatively small.
And it's a much better winter vehicle.
How much is actually driven as to how much it's on while they're doing their job, it's a pretty small factor.
And are those more maneuverable in weather?
It would clearly help us in weather situations.
Okay, thanks. Melissa?
It is important to note, I guess I should have prefaced this page with, these things are contingent upon council's approval and were not already incorporated into the other budget. So what we were looking at was just operating. So if council approves any of these items, I will fold those into the budgets for the discussion at the next council meeting.
Well, we can't approve it. What we can...
That's true.
I mean, what I would... My personal feeling is that you should
put them in there,
just
maybe
put them in there, and then we can
out.
Talk about taking them out.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
So we'll just go ahead and explain them.
Okay. We've got Streetscape. We've got the Streetscape actually split between the Street Fund and the Electric Fund. So this would be phase three, and that is from Short Street.
Quarry to Short.
Quarry to Short Street.
On the west side of the road, right?
I thought we were going to try to finish it.
I
thought we were going to try to get
Jason
down the limestone.
Jason would love to go ahead and finish that, but it's probably going to double that cost. So that's why I said just put one phase in. But Jason would definitely be in favor of, and Johnny would too. But. They would just as soon have the project done.
So by just going from Short to Corey, what is left?
From Short to Limestone, mm-hmm. There by the church and the funeral home and the bank. It's basically straight sidewalk.
Yeah, that's what, you know.
There aren't as many services, there are not as many street lights, but there also aren't the trees and the other amenities.
But maybe we should be adding those. The other section that I'm interested in wondering about is the section on the other side by Speedway, because we're going to have brand mm-hmm. new sidewalk in front of the hotel. We've got brand new sidewalk the rest of the area, mm-hmm. and then we've got that little section in front of Speedway that is not in good shape. And I would love to potentially talk to Speedway Corporate about working with us to do some improvements there.
Mm-hmm. I mean, staff was very much in favor of completing it to at least Limestone on the west side of the road, and I nixed the idea. But if council wants to put it in there.
How much money is in that street fund? How much money do we?
What's the balance?
The way I have it right now, it would get the reserves down to where it would need to be. But with this, it would require a higher transfer that comes over from the general fund.
So but ultimately,
because I would be uncomfortable with dipping into the reserves below the recommended amounts. So it would just increase the transfer that would come.
But there is enough money in there to move an extra $100,000 over.
Yeah, the general fund at the end of...
No, I mean...
It would have to come from the general fund.
And there would be some cost savings if we... I mean, ultimately, if we finish all at one...
Likely, yes.
I would suggest that staff consider that for the next go-round, and then council can make a decision one way or the other.
Finish the west side, and yes. then what we would have left is Limestone.
Yeah, especially with
finish all of it.
Finish all of it, including the Speedway section.
Yes.
Yes.
Are you both okay with that?
Yeah.
I just think if you don't do that size when we're looking at complete.
But are you comfortable with doing it all at the same time?
Yes.
Johnny?
I don't have enough lights. If you had Mills Lawn and Speedway, I'd have to buy more lights, which I'm okay with. I just want to have streetscape was not. When it was drawn up,
was not on that side.
Limestone or Speedway.
Right.
Or it did not include the hotel and Speedway.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But
you're comfortable with going ahead and, I mean, so you can do that. There's.
I agree with Jason. I think you'll get a better concrete price if you do it all one time.
Okay, why don't you guys get some prices together, give it to Melissa, and we'll look at doing the rest of streetscape and getting it all done.
The general fund at the end of 16, based on my projections, are going to have about $700,000 more than the minimum reserves. So we would have a little bit of cushion to be able to play with if we wanted to transfer more money to cover those costs.
Right.
At least for the streets part, Electric would be able to handle their portion.
Okay,
Parks and Rec Improvement.
I'm sorry, but where was streetscape originally supposed to... B.
Jason, Johnny?
Start at Corey and go south.
It was supposed to start at Corey and go all the way to Limestone.
On both sides?
On both sides. Oh. The one side that kind of got nixed was the side that Karen is referring to from Glen to Limestone. But since the hotel came in and put in brand new sidewalks, all we have to do is basically take off from where they stopped all the way to Glen Street.
Well, was the west side nixed at that time or not? Oh.
Okay, we've got Parks and Rec Improvement Fund. That fund still has a relatively healthy balance. It's right around $250,000, if I remember right off the top of my head. So these are some things that are very minimal improvements. This says $3,500, though. The renovator was dropped down, right, Jason, to $3,100 from $3,500. So the $3,500 figure out to the left should be $3,100. I know that was a last-minute change that we made.
What does that involve?
The rejuvenator is basically two attachments that go on a piece of machine that we already have. And basically what it does is it skims a thin layer, the grass. grass roots and everything, so it keeps your edges nice and cut. But the way that we're doing it now is we're tilling it, and it's breaking up the base. So you're having hills and valleys, and it's holding water. And actually talking to Ted Mercer, who rejuvenated our ball diamonds, he said that that's actually the worst thing you can do is till. You actually need to find a piece of machinery. And what this will do will skim the grass out of there, and it has a drag on the back, and it will level everything off and get back in.
Perfect. I knew that there were concerns with the baseball, with the teams and with the players, and we put a big investment in renovating those fields, so I'm glad we're going to invest in that equipment.
Yes.
Thank you.
I have two questions about parks, not directly related to this, though, but what happened with the bridge that was supposed to be at Ellis Park? Did that...
The bridge is still being talked about. Roger Bill is working for the tree committee side on the walkway, and we just are going back and forth about that. He doesn't have a clear-cut plan, so he's just kind of updating me as we go. So there hasn't been really anything.
So he's designing it?
He's designing the pathway.
Oh,
but not the bridge?
But not the bridge.
The bridge that Jason and I talked about last was a wooden structure that would go up and over two culvert pipes. Is that correct, Jason? And hopefully be done by an Eagle Scout as a project. But in order to make that fit with whatever the path is going to be, we have to kind of know what the path is going to be.
Yeah. Where it's going to be, especially.
Yeah. And I think there were some hopes that there might be some donations, that would be a perfect project for some donations. Yeah. I had received one phone call that nothing ever happened from that, but I mean, it could be something that we worked with the tree committee on some joint fundraising.
Correct.
Now, the other thing is that I've got a sheet from one of the local residents, and Beaver Creek just completed a bridge rebuild, so I'm going to talk with their park superintendent about how they're doing about it, because it's supposed to be a composite bridge, and it's supposed to cost a fraction of what we originally proposed for a concrete and steel bridge.
Yeah, those are nice.
Okay, thank you. And the question, how did it work this summer with the ball teams? Because I know that was a new thing.
It worked well, really well. Everybody's excited. The fall ball had 8 teams that signed up. We're down to 5 because they just didn't want to play. But the interest is definitely growing. It's definitely growing.
Thank you.
And the team Frisbee seemed to finally settle on an area.
Yeah, I think once we kind of walked out there and basically said, here's the layout, and you could fit everything in there, I think they were more comfortable with that.
Right, they're still under the lights.
Yeah,
and
right.
they're still under the lights. Yeah, so, I mean, they really didn't move. They just didn't think about angling the field the way that Jason had laid it out before we put the fences up.
Oh, well, good.
So I'm pretty sure that's handled.
Good.
Okay. Melissa.
Okay, gutter valve replacement at the pool for $4,000. And then repair the Bryan Center gym ceiling and then painting it as well. Mm-hmm. So that total, there was something that happened with that formula over there. The total for that for 2016, off to the right, $12,100 out of Parks and Rec Improvement for those projects. Then we skip down to the electric fund. We have $25,000 allocated for that portion of streetscape, which would be the electric. $10,000 for pole replacements. And that was as a result of the inspections that were done this year. And then we've got LED lighting for the Bryan Center parking lot and the electric stations at $25,000 for that work.
Johnny, I have a question. $10,000 for poles is not a whole lot, considering will you be caught up enough that that's enough for your poles?
Well, I just ordered $12,000 worth of poles. We already spent, as of that one, we've spent $22,000 just in poles this year.
Okay.
Hopefully the $12,000 I just ordered will take me to June.
Okay.
And then I can order another $10,000 to get me to December and keep on.
Okay. But you're comfortable that that's enough? Because when I saw it, I was a little...
I think I can make it work. I mean, because we got this big water project, so...
All right.
My poles are scheduled to be delivered today or this week, but I think I'll be all right.
Okay.
So that's the electric fund. We skip down to water. For distribution, there are three projects there, but there's only one for 2016. The other two are just to be on your radar. We have fire hydrant replacement allocated at $15,000, and Johnny recommended that that be taken out each year for 5 years. We also have, for 2017, a water line from Cemetery to Fairfield at $25,000. And then this project is kind of up in the air. This could possibly be folded into another project, but it's there just in case as a placeholder. GISing of fire hydrants in 2017 for $10,000. So the only project for this year would be $15,000 for fire hydrant replacement.
And another question, how many hydrants does that get you?
For 15,000?
Yeah.
5 a year.
Okay, because I know right now you have 3 or 4.
I have 4 out of service.
Right.
Due to the last fire hydrant.
Do you have money in the budget for this year to do those?
I've got money this year.
Okay.
Okay, and we don't have any projects scheduled for water treatment for 2016. However, Brad did want to put on the radar that he would like to request a new pickup truck in 2017. And that would be split, of course, between water treatment and sewer treatment. And then in the sewer fund for sewer collection, we've got sewer relining, but that's not to begin until 2018, and then that's earmarked at $50,000 for 3 years. So the total of the capital projects for 2016 would be $202,100.
And that will obviously increase with this change in streetscape.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. I have a question about sewer relining. Brad, can you explain?
Sewer relining is Jason.
Jason.
And actually,
yay. Jason.
I can explain sewer relining because that's why we're moving some money into the sewer capital so that we can start on sewer relining. And what Jason needs to do is take the CMOM report and start getting some prices. The bad part is that $25,000 doesn't give you a whole lot of sewer relining because of the mobilization fees. But are you asking about the process?
So what are you looking at, where there are potential or actual leaks and then putting a new line within the sewer? Or what
it's just the age of the line itself. We have two sections of concrete that have tar seals, and it's over its useful life. So after talking to Wayne Cannon, he would like to see us reline those to give us better life out of those. And it's a section on Zinni Avenue, and then there's a section that runs down Court Street to the tree.
So how do you reline it?
Basically what they do is put a machine in there, and they pull it, and it just regrouts the line as it goes down, so all of the outer seal is one surface.
It basically creates a new pipe inside the old pipe.
Mm-hmm. Huh. Okay.
And you don't have to dig anything up. Mm-hmm. You go in through a manhole.
Mm-hmm. So does anybody have any questions on budget? Because that wraps it up.
I think Brad's been awful quiet, and somebody needs to ask him.
Yeah. Are we going to start a new water plant in 2017?
And Melissa, I like how this is organized so that you can see where it's coming out of, you know, general fund versus enterprise fund. Thanks for doing that.
Yeah, this was you've made budget discussions as much of a joy as it can possibly be.
It was complicated. This year was complicated in the supplemental appropriations that you guys are going to see in the beginning of December, trying to keep track of everything that's going on right now. Mm-hmm. There's a lot happening.
And I would just like to give kudos to Melissa for this wonderful job that she did. I mean, I know there are a couple of hiccups in the formula, but this is an unbelievably massive process that she goes through just to get here. Not only does she do her own projections, but she talks to every department head, and then she ends up with me, and it keeps going, it seems like. So I would just like to say great job.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah. Melissa, do you want to say anything about the 5-year projection that shows with or without the levy? Or?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that was the other, you know what? I didn't have that printed out for myself. That's why I glossed right over it.
I have a hard copy if you need one.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I glossed right over it. That's basically the same thing. It was just slightly updated with the figures from the budget, the original budget presentation, but it just shows out 5 years what it looks like if we continue the levy and if we do not continue the levy. And you can see that there's a huge gap without that levy.
Yes.
Yes.
$700,000 is a lot of money considering our property taxes are only about $900,000, and $700,000 of that being the levy is huge. But then again, though, it does underscore the importance of the levy, but should, I don't even want to say it out loud, I mean, there are options that I'd presented with income tax as well if we would ever need to visit that. So. Mm-hmm.
So the budget for 2016 shows about $250,000 loss.
Without the levy?
No, with the levy.
With the levy. Well, with the levy.
No, with the levy, it's got a profit. That color should not have. It, before I reran the figures, it was in the red, so now it's in the black.
Yeah, it's not in parentheses.
It's not in parentheses, so that's a positive amount.
Oh, so the red
is it's not a loss. But then again, though, that's going to change because I have to increase some of those transfers and such with the capital that we just talked about. Uh-huh. So I will update this with all of the budget changes and bring it back to council next meeting.
Yeah, and just keep in mind that if it's a loss, it will be in parentheses.
It will be in parentheses,
okay, I was looking at the color.
Right.
Yeah. The color could have got changed.
Yeah, and
when I play with those numbers, I have to remember sometimes the colors need to be changed.
And this will be an important document for the levy committee.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Okay.
All of our questions have been answered. So at the next meeting, we will review the whole budget updated.
And you guys can all go except for Johnny because I want you to stay until we do the.
Okay.
Are we done with the budget?
We are, I believe, yes.
Okay, I'd like to excuse myself.
Okay. Thanks, Jerry. Mm-hmm. See you guys. So next, we're going to talk about the water and sewer rate increase ordinances. Towards the end of the last meeting, and as part of Melissa's report, there was a comment made about in her report about the readiness for service charge. Mm-hmm. And I will say that it alerted me because I was, it made me concerned that it was going to be an additional increase that we were looking at adding at some point in the future. It's been clarified that. That's not the case, that was actually one option that Wayne Cannon provided as a way for us to increase our water revenue, our water and sewer revenue. So that was one of the things, that was one of the reasons that we were going to discuss it. And the other reason it's on this agenda is because it was one of those items that we were going to do as a reading and not a vote. But we decided we should keep it on the agenda in case there were citizens that were here to discuss it or concerned about it. I don't know that, has anything changed? I mean, nothing in those ordinances have changed. We'll have the second reading at the next meeting.
Yeah, mm-hmm. The table has changed a little bit just to clean it up, but none of the dollar amounts have changed.
Well, it added the multi-year that was requested
right.
by council.
Okay.
That's it, yeah.
Council, any other comments or questions from Melissa? So we will hear that at the next meeting. Next, we have our manager and assistant manager reports.
GM Pipeline is moving along very quickly on the bottleneck elimination. Johnny, are they still on track to start hooking up the services or charging the line and then testing?
We're actually charging the line tomorrow morning from Herman to Allen.
Okay.
Or just south of Allen to the fire hydrant. And then they will actually pressurize it. We should get at least one test back by Friday. Take another one on Monday, and then they'll jump back and start hooking up the services.
Yeah, they have to get two clear tests before they can hook the services up. Once they get both tests back, they'll start hooking up the services from Herman to Allen to get those folks on the new line, and then they want to get the sidewalks laid before the weather gets too cold.
And how will they do that, Johnny? I mean, like how many services can they get hooked up in a day?
They will actually make all the taps first
have
it ready, and then they will transfer it to the last. They'll get the homeowner's permission to shut their water off and make a transfer. Both lines will be charged.
For how long? I mean, how long will they be without water?
Oh.
No, and maybe an hour.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Nobody should be without water for more than an hour. They'll have everything there ready to do, the hole be dug and everything before they shut
and
the water.
Because both lines will be charged side by side.
Right, and then when are you doing the west side extensions?
Connections. To go across the road, they'll actually bore those at the same time. So
okay.
They've already got the taps heading that way. They've got a 4-inch line that they've got to hook up. All the other ones that need to go across there will be bored underneath 68.
Okay.
And that process for the taps will take, what, a week, 10 days?
Probably 10 days. They are actually, they got in 300-foot of pipe today.
Wow.
They're 100-foot north of Brookside. So we expect them to be probably in front of the two garages right there tomorrow. And then more than likely they're going to be to the end before we go to sample.
And how far, where is the line ending?
It's going to KO.
And how will the connection at the restaurant, are they getting a new connection or not?
All the way to the Mexican restaurant?
Yeah.
No, it stops at KO.
Okay. Yeah. So they're already on a larger line?
They're on the larger line.
Okay.
And the larger line, just so you know, the last one that we did, the first project, that would run a 12-inch from the tower to Herman Street. Just to show you the impact that it did, this is the first year that they've been able to flush multiple hydrants before Herman Street because the pressure would drop so bad that French Care and everybody else would not have enough pressure to run if they opened two hydrants. Mm-hmm. We got done actually 2.5 days early on the fire hydrant flushing because we started off with two hydrants the whole entire time.
Oh, that's
great. And
then
at one time we actually had three.
And is YSI, are they already on a larger line also?
Yes. They will only increase, the 12-inch line will help them out as well, but they're on a large 8-inch already.
Okay.
The Public Works crew was hoping to be finished with the line on Davis Street, but they've decided to extend it a little bit further all the way to High. So, they're still out there working, but they should finish this week. Paving is done. Okay, there is an additional report in your packet regarding electric meter installation. Johnny actually looked into having a company install these because he has obviously a personal issue right now, a little bit of shortage and people trying to get their vacations in and et cetera. And the additional benefits of having the one company, which is the lower of the two prices, HD Supply at $31,000, they would do additional things like taking pictures of each meter, scanning each meter barcode in so we know the location of it, GISing it, making personal contact with the homeowner, notifying our staff if, in fact, it is not to code for whatever reason. What else am I missing, Johnny?
I think that's about it. They'll actually make it easier to the billing software to integrate it by computerizing it versus doing it manually. So HD is actually the people that's supplying the meters, and they sent me a whole list of what they're going to do.
Yeah.
And they also are pricing to GPS the fire hydrants at the same time.
Right. I suggested to Johnny, instead of putting that off, since it is something that we're going to have to do for the EPA, that if they're going to be in here with the software, let's see if they can do it for us at a nominal cost.
Sounds good.
So what we will need from council is some direction as to whether to bring that resolution. I think it's a good idea. Johnny recommends it, and I agree with him. So
staff should do what they think is best.
All righty. Water plant process. We have agreed for the three shortlisted firms to extend the time that is given to them to prepare their presentations before council. So that timetable is changing, and we will now have the presentation at a public meeting from the design build firms on Thursday, December 10th at 6 p.m. here in this room. So if everyone could please mark their calendars for that, and I will get you a full schedule out of the remaining process as soon as I get that from Sam.
Judy, Patty, can you remind us, when was it originally?
It was originally scheduled for
November 27th.
The 17th 20, of November.
17th, okay.
Yeah, the 17th of November originally.
Okay.
The electric rate structure, the Energy Board was previously tasked by council with recommending a rate structure for the electric utility. To that end, they did meet with John Courtney at the last meeting and recommended moving forward with the flat rate structure, which you see in your handouts, an explanation of the flat rate structure and what it entails. If anyone has any questions about that, we can talk about it, and then council can pass a motion at the next meeting, giving direction to John. So
could you provide, and it doesn't have to be tonight, maybe it will be at the next meeting, but I'd just like to have a better understanding of how it's going to impact commercial and industrial users.
Actually, it won't have, I don't think, much of an impact on commercial users, but the large users would probably actually save a little money, right, Johnny?
I believe it was correct. I think they're going to save a little bit, but it won't have an impact on them at all.
What about smaller business users?
It shouldn't really impact them at all, because the only thing it's going to do is basically change the rate structure, the tiered rate structure for the larger users, because the phase one commercial users are basically using the same tier right now, correct, mm-hmm. as residential.
Okay.
So I wouldn't think that would have an enormous impact on them.
Okay.
But I can check with John and see if I'm correct in that. Let me find where I'm at here.
And was that his recommendation?
It was actually his recommendation. He says it's a very equitable structure. It actually would give the commercial users the choice of either continuing without a demand charge or taking the demand charge at a slightly lower rate during their peak hours. So that will be a choice that will be given to them, and they can make that choice on their own.
Okay.
He actually recommended it as a one of the better structures that most smaller villages are going to.
Okay.
Mary Ann, did
you
want to?
Yeah, and we had a conversation, and I'm mostly thinking about residential users. We had a conversation about, not rewarding people for using more electricity.
Correct.
In other words, not lowering the rate as people use more electricity, which was one reason to go to the flat rate. We also talked about, can you reward people for using less electricity? And that discussion seemed to indicate that that's pretty difficult to do. it's both difficult to do in terms of people's in, well, one thing, can you charge people who are on a fixed income or lower income less? That's one thing. Or how would you reward people for using less? But there's a fairness issue, like maybe you have one person that doesn't use much electricity compared to a family of six people that uses more because there are more people.
Right.
So that's how it seemed like a flat rate was sort of a middle ground in that regard.
Well,
and then the other thing that John Courtney brought up that I'm going to recommend that the HRC promote, but I will say here, is that you know, there's been a concern about lower income people and people not being able to pay their utilities. So John said that some communities have on the utility bill that you get the option really to round up or give an extra amount. And so, like, let's say my bill is $68, my utility bill, and I round up to 70 or 75. That extra $2 or $7 can go into a fund.
Mm-hmm.
And that fund can then go to an organization that would work with people who are having trouble with their utilities.
Right, and that kind of ties hand in glove with what Chrissy has
yes.
been talking about with her. She's
been,
trying to get
yes.
her group going, and that was an idea that she had as
yeah.
well.
Yeah.
So,
I do want to point out, though, that increased use of electricity and utilities is not necessarily a bad thing if it's in, if it's because a business is growing or because they're
correct.
Increasing productivity. So that's my concern about penalizing businesses who use more electricity because they're growing, not because they're cranking up the AC or something. They're using it to actually produce income.
Right.
So I think I want to be very careful. If John Courtney said it's equitable and it's okay,
yeah.
I'm fine with that. But
yeah.
I want to be really careful about not making it seem like it's a bad thing. Or making it seem like it is a bad thing to be using more electricity when it actually could be a good thing.
Right, and the flat rate is actually one of the most equitable because it does give you a certain amount of control over, you know, you if you decrease your use, you decrease your bill. If you increase your use, you increase it, but you increase it at a steady rate. You know what to expect. So
right.
in
okay.
that regard, it is one of the most equitable.
Okay.
Planning and zoning, you do have a report in your packets from Denise Swinger regarding text amendments that were brought before the Planning Commission for adoption, and they have been reviewed by legal counsel. My report does say that it's staff's recommendation to move forward with these. However, there is one that after discussion amongst staff, we approached Matt and Matt Reed and Lori Askeland about pulling the pool amendment, primarily because I have some concerns that is not, it's not complete enough. So I believe that was what Lori was going to recommend tonight. We can hold off on that until the next meeting. But when you read through those text amendments, we do need to get them passed, and council will have to give direction to legal to bring it as an ordinance, as an amendment. But if we can't do that tonight, so.
So are you saying that it will be on the next agenda as, next meeting as legislation?
Yes.
Okay.
Trick or treat, October 31st from 6 to 8. Bonfires should be in the regular places. Correspondence, the Public Works crew will be repainting the no bikes on sidewalk notices on the sidewalks in a pyramidal fashion. And that is all I have, unless someone has questions.
It has come up that our stickers on our recycling containers may be not reflecting sort of the current recycling, and
ours downtown.
No, the ones I mean residential.
The Rumpke ones.
Yes. So I guess I wanted to. I mean, I don't know if you know with the new contract we're getting new stickers. I just wanted to follow up on that.
I don't think we're getting any new stickers. The recycling containers are from Rumpke themselves.
No, I understand, but we've had those containers for how long? So one of the things that has come up is like, you know, the size of the screw top that used to be an issue if it was smaller than the bottle, and maybe that's not an issue anymore.
Oh.
So if we can just check that.
Oh, I understand. You mean the stuff on top that says
that tells
yes
you
and
what
no.
you can and can't do.
Okay. We
that
could
may
check
have
into
changed.
That. Yeah, yep. We could check into that. But here's what Rumpke told us when we met with them: what you can recycle changes every month. So if you have a question, put it in your recycle, and if it cannot be recycled, they will sort it out. But you're better to put it in your recycle. Because it does consistently change what they can and can't
right.
use.
And that's actually what Tom told me, and I started doing that.
Yeah. If you have a question as to whether this heavy piece of plastic can be recycled or not, put it in your recycle and let Rumpke figure it out. But we will check into the information.
Okay. Melissa?
Nothing major for me. Budget. Denise and I did write that grant and submitted it to MVRPC about the ADA compliant sidewalk ramps. She went to a meeting since then, and they said that since those are federal dollars, it could be a couple years before we would see that money, even if we would get it. So that's kind of unfortunate to hear that it could be quite a while, but we did get it submitted.
I have a question. Can we go back to CDBG, go through the county to get some of that money?
We've
gotten it before.
Mm-hmm. We can, but the cycle's already done for this year, so we would have to wait until next spring to apply. But we can certainly try.
The information that we got from Haynes Engineering, though, was really, really good. Mm-hmm. So, if we can throw out a couple of lines, that would be great. Okay, and then Smart Bill is going to be processing and mailing our disconnect letters. We actually sent them the file today. It's going to cost an extra $6, and that was taking like a half a day with two people doing it. So the cost savings benefit from that's huge. That company I've been really pleased with it so far. So that's it for me.
Great. Next we have standing reports. Both of our planning commission reps are missing. Patty, do you have anything to report?
Planning did forward the text amendments on to council with their approval. We did approve one conditional use for a new business to open down on Herman Street. And that is all I know.
Okay. Neither Lori nor I were able to attend Greene County Regional Planning. Marianne, I think. No, Brian's next.
Okay. So first of all, I guess the main thing to report for the Arts and Culture Commission is that the VITA, the Village mm-hmm. Inspiration Design Award, that presentation was postponed. So we'll be letting people know when that's rescheduled. But we did award it to Alan Macbeth and what I know has been called the Odin Gallery up by Speedway. Really cool building and great patio and whatnot. Regarding the community access panel.
I'd like to
yes,
say something
please do.
About that. I nominated Alan
Thank you.
For that award. And when I moved to Yellow Springs in 1972, Alan, as I recall, was working on that structure. And people may not know it, but Alan is an amazing artist. And he has done some great portraits in Yellow Springs of Yellow Springs people. But I sort of look at that building as his life's work because he's been doing it for probably at least half his life. And more than any other structure in town, I think that exemplifies Yellow Springs. And, you know, we walk past it so often that we might not think about it very often. But that property is an amazing work of art. And if you haven't been back inside and seen the landscaping that he's done in the back, it's incredible. And, you know, it used to sort of define the very edge of the downtown. But now it's getting encompassed by the hotel because the hotel and, you know, even the library are sort of defining the edge. But I just think it's such a unique piece, and so I really felt like I wanted to, Alan to be honored. So unfortunately, had to go into the hospital.
Yeah, he's got pneumonia.
And I will say, I agree with Mary Ann. It epitomizes why we're doing this award. And we've been getting other nominations, and that's on a rolling basis. So it's a seasonal award. And I think at this point, the easiest way to, if you have a nomination, is to direct those to Judy, so clerk@yso.com. And regarding the community access panel, Channel 5's going great, lots of fun stuff. I would encourage people to tune in. The other thing that we talked about last month is there's been a lot of progress made on really good quotations and numbers for both the wireless downtown project as well as the fiber to the home. So the plan is for SpringsNet and the community access panel to bring some of that to council soon. So. Last thing I thought I'd just mention, because we'll be putting it on the reports moving forward, is the Economic Sustainability Commission. We finally did get at least 4 applicants, and to get the commission started, we need 4+1, the council liaison. So Karen and I will be doing those interviews, and we should have some members and get meetings started very soon.
Okay.
Mary Ann?
The Energy Board met, and we met with John Courtney, and Patty has already discussed what we talked about at the Energy Board. The Environmental Commission met with Krista McGaw, and a good part of that meeting was talking about what I've already reported on regarding priorities for conservation easements. We talked about the glass farm and the water samples that had been taken. Which indicated then that, I think actually Patty found out after our meeting happened, but that the water samples came back in showing very, very minor levels of contaminants. One thing that we talked about, and I forgot to bring it to council, was the concept of celebrating Wellhead Protection Day. So when the Wellhead Protection Plan was originally adopted, it actually wasn't adopted, but when it was completed, Wellhead Protection Day was supposed to be, I guess, the 5th of October.
Yes, I actually found that proclamation.
Mm-hmm. So we were going to start celebrating it this year, but I forgot.
Well, we could always make it a different day.
Yeah, we could. Could do that. Maybe we'll do that. We talked, so those were the main topics of our meeting. HRC met. I brought up the some of the things that have come out of the Community Solutions Conference about the time bank. I think I maybe said something about that at our last council meeting, and mutual aid networks, and I'll be finding out more about that. We had Chrissy Cruz discussed progress that she's making with the Yellow Springs Assistance Network. She has several people who are involved in forming a board on that, and she's going to get some seed money and have some fundraising about that. HRC had an idea for when we have our ACE task force discussion of having people bring a can of food when they come to that meeting that would go to the food pantry. So HRC will meet after that meeting. So.
Correct.
So I guess if we're going to do that, we should advertise that.
I'm sure Susan can put something on the
okay.
Channel 5 for you.
Okay. Does that cover it? Yep, that covered it. Okay.
Chamber, we've got a meeting scheduled for a date that we don't normally meet. It's actually the last Thursday in October, October 29th. It's a breakfast meeting at 9 o'clock, and we will be having all of the building and code officials attending that meeting, including Patty and Denise representing the village, Richard Zoff representing the township, Al Kuzma representing the building department, and Debbie Leopold representing the health department. There's no intention of, the goal is to get people to understand the rules and the reason for the rules, not to discuss current issues that are playing out in the newspaper and in meetings everywhere. So, you know, it's to try to clear up misunderstandings and get some educational information out there. I want to thank Lisa Goldberg for doing 15 artist studio tours over the last, I'm not sure how many years. This was her last one, last weekend was the last one. They were excellent, brought a lot of people to town, and really showed this community as a great arts community. She is continuing with Art and Soul, a Yellow Springs art fair. That will be November 21st at Mills Lawn. And then after that, that is somewhat the kickoff of Holiday in the Springs, but it really kicks off the following weekend with Yellow Friday. So there'll be a lot happening. I'm working with some folks at Mills Lawn on some things that they're doing. So it's looking to be an exciting holiday season. We're also working with Little Art Theater. They're going to be doing a holiday film festival also. MVRPC, the big thing there is, it's actually been in the Dayton paper a lot, trying to get funding for Route 35 to remove the at-grade intersections at Factory Road, Orchard Lane, and Valley. They're incredibly dangerous. It's a $100 million project. Mm-hmm. I'm loath to spend that kind of money on highways, but it is a horribly dangerous situation. There are accidents on a daily basis. The traffic jam is ridiculous. They are the only at-grade intersections on the entire stretch of Route 35 from Ohio to West Virginia. So it would basically, it should have been done 30 years ago or 30 or 40 years ago, but all those car dealerships along 35 basically fought it, stonewalled the whole thing. So unfortunately it's become, you know, kind of an emergency project at this point. So that's it. So you can see that we've got, so the next thing on the agenda is the October 29th, 7 p.m. You can see what our agenda looks like until the rest of the year. For that reason, at the last agenda planning, we made the decision, or we at least thought we would make the recommendation to make all of the remaining meetings in 2015 regular meetings instead of work sessions. There's too much, basically, because we've got all of this legislation to deal with. Mm-hmm. And it's just getting cumbersome to have a meeting like we did tonight and not be able to make a decision, not be able to hear legislation. So remember also that all those meetings will be starting at 6:30, except for the October 29th meeting. And I just noticed something. Let's go through and then we'll discuss. So right now, at this point, we've got 13 pieces of legislation on the November 2nd agenda, and that doesn't include the zoning code, so we're going to have 14.
Or the easement priorities, or the resolution for HD Supply.
Wow, so we're going to have
16
pieces of legislation.
Resolution to award.
Yep, HD Supply.
Can we hear all of the ones that are about basically changing the ordinances about our commissions, those should all go relatively quickly. We can read them all in by title, but there's a lot of them. Chris, are we planning on hearing those as an emergency? It's not saying that, but they aren't on.
It was not my belief it was an emergency to change the...
How are we justifying the emergency for the municipal income tax?
Because it has to be done effective January 1, and we don't have enough time to get it done before.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, so just remember, Judy, on November 16th, we need to put all of those, we need to put all those second readings.
Yeah, I just didn't want to have to bind this thing.
So I know. Yeah. So then November 16th, it will be the budget, the first reading of the budget, and then that will be time. You know, my feeling is if we are going to take up discussion of something like the ACE task force, we can do it in a regular meeting.
Right.
And so then we've got, again, we'll have a lot of resolutions, a lot of legislation December 7th. December 10th, Judy, that meeting is supposed to start at 6. It says 7.
6 or 6:30.
I thought the water plant.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
Right. It is at 6 o'clock.
It is at 6.
6 o'clock.
December 10th
right.
at 6.
And we could hold out hope that we don't have to have a December 21st meeting. There isn't anything there. What?
I'm with you.
Anything else that you're...
Well, one thing that's, I think we should finalize before the end of the year is the local policing vision statement that has now been revised. So the piece that Lori was going to do and the new short statement are mm-hmm. in there now. So that document's
So then let's go. Add that to November 16th and 7th. Is that, yep. That's just a resolution, right?
Yep.
Okay. Right.
That has totally been changed.
Oh. And not that I'm anxious to do this or anything, but my evaluation has to be in there somehow.
Yeah.
So no November.
Have we gotten the paperwork we're supposed to have?
We have most of it. So.
And that was on the agenda and it got dropped.
I guess I got a little overwhelmed there, so I'll resend the agenda with all that added, because I didn't have it on.
Yeah, and I don't know when it was, but...
I was just looking at it today.
Village manager evaluation, December 7th.
Is that right? The direct reports are going to have their feedback by next week. And then subsequent to that, council's got our forms to fill out, and then Lori and I are going to compile that information.
Okay, great. And when will we get those forms, you said?
By tomorrow.
Okay.
And direct reports are getting theirs tomorrow, too.
Yep.
So.
Okay, sounds good. Anything else to add? I think we don't have any room to add anything. Motion to adjourn.
Move.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you all.